I think that's a good place to praise him. Peace is a fruit of God's spirit, and you ought to say something. Hug somebody behind you and say, I speak peace, let there be peace. Glory to God. I said, glory to God. I said, glory to God. In spite of the circumstances, I speak peace. In spite of the sickness, I speak peace. In spite of the killing, I still peace.
Your grace, God, I need.
snap your finger like this if you don't mind. So many things God has brought us out of. So many things he's brought us through. But tonight we stand before you with a new testimony, and we say, wonderful change has come over me. Here we go. Wonderful change. Put your hand on his head.
Hi, I'm Pastor Lloyd T. McGriff, and welcome to worship with the Galilee Church family. For the next few moments, our prayer is that God will do something great in your life. All we ask is that you listen with an attentive ear, an open mind, and a receptive heart. At Galilee, we believe in WED, worship, evangelism, and discipleship. Come on, let's worship God together, for He alone is worthy to be praised. God bless you.
This song is a very easy song that you all may already know. Join it with me. Easy.
Thank you.
We're so thankful and appreciative that you took the time to join us this morning. Listen, we believe God has a word specifically tailored for you. Look at how time has passed. We find ourselves even in the midst of a pandemic, giving God the glory. And I do mean that, give him the glory. Praise God for your joining today. Here we are at a first Sunday in a new month, August. Many of you facing this new month, perhaps it's your birthday, listen, in your own way, celebrate it. For every day above ground is a day to give thanks. And you got to learn how to celebrate, appreciate what God has done, is doing, and shall do. This first Sunday in August, summer almost spent, we can see time does pass. And in the midst of that, we find if it's not one thing, it's something else. I mean, really, dealing with the impact of this coronavirus, our prayers to all of our servants who are working on the front line, be encouraged, be uplifted. Know that there are those giving intercessory prayer on your behalf to the bereaved families. We continue to keep them in prayer. I want to pause here and say somebody knows firsthand that life really is like a roller coaster ride. You have ups, you have downs. In other words, many times if it's not one thing, it's another. Truth be told, there's always something. So you gotta make up your mind. I'm gonna just trust God. I was sharing with many of our leaders just the other day, where would you be? Where would I be? Where would we be if we didn't have a relationship with Jesus Christ? I mean, really, the Lord is our anchor. Somebody knows exactly what I'm talking about. I want you to respond right there because you know God has kept you when you couldn't keep yourself. Truth be told, if it had not been for the Lord on our side, I thought about where we are today. A hurricane is coming up the coast. Hurricane Isaias is headed north. A hurricane with hurricane gale winds and storm surges. The meteorologist talks about damage to be expected, landfall, who's impacted, shelters, storm. I mean, when you reflect on your own life, if it's not this, it's that. There's always something. And it occurred to me, storms, they come. And you know for yourself, if you're not in a storm, you just got out of a storm. If you're not just out of a storm, you're headed for a storm. I mean, it seems to just come with the territory. And I thought today we ought to look at a word that addresses, that directly relates and correlates with storms. It's in Acts, the 27th chapter. Storms are no strangers to believers. It's in that 27th chapter of Acts. We find in the 27th chapter, Paul is en route to Rome. Around the first verse, you find Paul en route to Italy. There's a long journey ahead, and as he's preparing to go forward, you and I can sense and see, because we can read the text, what unfolds. But Paul is given insight by the Holy Spirit of what will lie ahead. He knows that imminent danger is coming. In fact, when you look at Acts 27, you take the time, read the entire chapter. However, today I want to launch from what is verse number 18. And that 18th verse of the 27th chapter, it says, "And we being exceedingly tossed with a tempest, the next day they lightened the ship. And the third day we cast out with our own hands the tackling of the ship, and when neither sun nor stars in many days appeared and no small tempest lay on us, all hope that we should be saved was then taken away. But after long absence, Paul stood forth in the midst of them and said, Sirs, ye should have hearkened unto me and not have loosed from Crete, to have gained this harm and loss. And now I exhort you to be of good cheer, verse 22, for there shall be no loss of any man's life among you, but of the ship. For there stood by me this night the angel of God, whose I am, whom I serve, saying, Fear not, Paul, thou must be brought before Caesar. And lo, God hath given thee all them that sail with thee. Verse 25, Wherefore, sirs, be of good cheer. For I believe God that it shall be even as it was told me. Howbeit we must be cast upon a certain island. But when the 14th night was come, and we were driven up and down in Adria, about midnight the shipmen deemed that they drew near to some country. They sounded and found it 20 fathoms, and when they had gone a little further, they sounded again and found it 15 fathoms. Then, fearing lest we should have fallen upon rocks, they cast four anchors out of the stern and wished for the day. And as the shipmen were about to flee out of the ship, when they had let down the boat into the sea, under color, as though they would have cast anchors out of the foreship, Paul said to the centurion and to the soldiers, Hear this, except these abide in the ship, ye cannot be saved. I want to deal with the time allotted, seeking your prayers, stay with the ship. That's the subject, stay with the ship. The storm story is powerful in the 27th chapter. I shared earlier, by verse 1, Paul is en route to Italy. He has a long journey. And before the journey begins, you can see in verse 10, Paul has some insight on what lies ahead. Now, when you have a long journey ahead, it behooves you to have someone with expertise in terms of shipmanship, in terms of reading the signs, what lies ahead. However, in this text,
party that has insight on what really lies ahead has not necessarily been trained in nautical definitions, has not necessarily been trained in how to map out or set sail, but the person who has expertise is the one who's connected to God. I want to pause there because it's in verse 10. The one connected to God was Paul, and Paul has some advice for the perceived man in charge. It's in verse 10. And said unto them, sirs, I perceive that this voyage will be with hurt and much damage. Did you catch that? It's in verse 10. Paul says, I perceive this voyage is not going to go well, that we're going to deal with some issues ahead. God's prophet spoke of impending danger. God's man in place gave advice to those who would have an ear to hear. I sense it here. A word was rendered, given to advise and counsel. A warning was sounded off. Sir, I perceive that this voyage will be with hurt and much damage. Not only of the landing and ship, but also of our lives. God's man spoke. God used him to give instruction and direction. But the catch here is that you can't just hear the word, you gotta know how to act on it. Because by verse 11, look at that word, nevertheless. And I want to submit to you, a whole lot of people will hear God's message, but will conclude with this word, nevertheless. They still want to do it their way. They still listen to bad advice. They still lean towards their own understanding. Paul tells them that danger lies ahead. But verse 11 says, nevertheless. I sense it. Nevertheless, the centurion, the party that's in charge, the centurion, he believed the master and the owner of the ship. He believed the master and the owner over God's messenger. Oh, hearing is one thing, but doing is another. I want you to write that down. I want you to catch it. I want you to respond to that truth. Hearing is one thing, but doing is another. I'm often reminded about the preacher who tells a story about the man church who said, I'm a great believer. He was unemployed. He said, I'm a great believer. God's going to do something. I'm a great believer. I'm going to get a job. Kept shouting that Sunday after Sunday after Sunday. Finally, the pastor asked him, said, now, did you put in an application? He said, no. And I want to pause there. God will do some things for you, but you got to do some things for yourself. That it's not enough to just hear it, that you got to do something. Faith without works is dead. In this text, Paul gave them sound, solid advice. But the centurion chose to listen to the master and the owner of the ship. It's in verse 11. Listen to him more than those things which were spoken by Paul. It's so true today. So many people get influenced, are directed, let the wrong people get in their ear versus hearing what the Lord has to say. Nevertheless, the centurion believed the master and the owner of the ship more than those things which were spoken by Paul. Pride cometh before the fall. A stiff-necked people, a hard-hearted people, are headed to destruction. The centurion, because he had a title, centurion listens to the wrong voice. The centurion thought that the owner, the the one with the bling bling, the one with the finances, the one with the resources. The centurion thought that the owner was to be heated over Paul. This owner had no spiritual connection, had no relationship with God, but in the sight of the world, world elevation. Let me let you in, brothers and sisters. Money will come and go. They make it every day. But you better be clear you want a relationship with Jesus Christ. Somebody knows exactly what I'm talking about. This text is gripping. The storm lies ahead. Paul has given them a warning. Nevertheless, the centurion believed the master and the owner of the ship. You keep reading, and you'll find by verse 14, it says, but not long after, there arose against it a tempestuous wind called a Euroclide. Hurricane gale force winds, massive storm. They found themselves in the midst. It got so bad by verse 20, it says that they couldn't even see the sun nor the stars. This was a terrible storm. They were being tossed to and fro. They were shaken at their core. It was so bad that in the daytime, they couldn't see the sun. And in the nighttime, they couldn't visibly capture sight of the stars. It's bad. It's rough. It's a terrible thing to be at sea in the midst of a storm and you can't even see. You don't have any bearings of where you are. I mean, it got mighty bad. Took to the point that many were about to just throw in the towel, and in the midst of being tossed to and fro, in the midst of the storm and the winds and the waves, Paul again speaks. It's in verse 22. You see, when you got a relationship with God, you understand that he can speak to you even in the midst of storms. Our God is not limited by our visibility. Our God can meet you right where you are. It's there. Look at verse 22. It says, and now I exhort you to be of good cheer. Wait a minute. Paul, what kind of language are you using? Be of good cheer. The irony of the statement. They're in the midst of the storm. There's no visibility there at sea. But look at what God is doing through God's messenger. It says, I exhort you to be of good cheer, for there shall be no loss of any man's life among you, but of the ship. How do you speak with conviction? How do you speak with certainty like that, Paul? It's there in verse 23. For there stood by me this night the angel of God, whose I am and whom I serve. God put on dispatch an angel to speak to Paul. Be of good cheer, he says to the sailors. Be of good cheer. He begins to recite and speak. Look at verse 24. Fear not, Paul, thou must be brought before Caesar, and lo, God have given thee all them that sail with thee. In other words, God has got you and those riding with you. He reiterates, he says it again, verse 25, wherefore, sirs, be of good cheer, for I believe God. That's the underlying words. For I believe God. That's the power piece. Question today is, do you believe God? Do you believe God? Through the test, through the trial, through the tribulation, through the struggle, through the storm, through the uncertainty, do you believe God? Listen, it doesn't take much to praise God when everything's going well, when skies are blue, when the road is straight, when the surface is smooth. But can you praise him in the storm? Can you praise him in the struggle? Can you praise him in the midst of uncertainty? Can you trust in the Lord and lean not unto your own understanding? Can you really grab hold that they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength? They shall mount up with wings as an eagle. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Somebody ought to be able to testify right now, I believe God. I believe God's got my back. I believe God will fight my battles. I believe God will handle my enemies. I believe God will allow me to overcome my adversaries. I believe God. With an economy that shrinks, with leadership that's missing, with disease and illness, with sickness, with fear, I believe God. Oh, Paul, he says to those on the ship, be of good cheer. This storm, it keeps raging. Verse 27 says it's the 14th night, and they're still being tossed to and fro. It's a storm that's raging. But hear me, stay with the ship. Trust God. Hold to his unchanging hand. Paul, speaking to them, in the midst of being tossed to and fro, Paul sharing words of encouragement even when it doesn't look well. Paul, able to speak with faith and conviction regardless of his Kodak moment, how things appear to be. It says by verse 31 to the centurion this time, except these abide in the ship, ye cannot be saved. I want to speak to you today. The driving point, many have declared, the ship is the old ship of Zion. Church, you got to make up in your mind, I'm going to stick with the ship. Come hell or high water, I'm stick with the ship. I'm sticking with what's kept me, what's brought me, what sustained me. I know some people say the ship, the church is obsolete, but I came by to tell you, God still gets the glory. I know they say it's outdated, but I came by to tell you that God's word is still relevant today for truth, for justice. I came by to tell you, even when they say the church is out of touch, that the church can still lift grace and mercy, love and peace, joy and happiness. Praise God for the church. So somebody said, well, you know, the church is closed. No, the building is closed, but the church still runs on. Church is not limited by four walls. Church is wherever you are, wherever I am, wherever we are. Church is not brick and mortar. You better learn how to stick with the church. Thank God for the church. Where I could hear somebody say, he may not come when you want him, but he's always right on time. Thank God for the church. Where a testimony can still be lifted. He made a way. Keeps on keeping me. Keeps fighting my battles. Keeps on blessing me. Better stay with the church. Stick with the ship. Stay on board. Learn to hold to his unchanging hand. Listen, your relationship with God will keep you when nothing else will. Hurricanes coming. COVID-19 exists, but God is still in charge. Whose report will you believe? That's the question to be answered. That's the question that you got to come to grips with. You got to be able to declare, like Paul, in the midst of your storm, I believe God. That's the message today. That's what I want to leave with you today. That's what I want to encourage you with today. stay with the ship. Best way to stay with the ship is you have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Now is the time that you can accept him as your Lord and your Savior. Here I am, Lord. Use me. Right where you are. Make a decision. I accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. I believe that God has raised him from the dead. I confess my sins. You got to have your relationship with God for yourself. May the Holy Spirit speak to you right where you are. Whatever storm you may find yourself in, whatever frustration or uncertainty that is at your doorstep, I want you to be able to say now, Lord, I need you. I accept you as my Lord and Savior. Come into my life. I confess my sins. I turn it all over to you. That's the power of making a decision and having a relationship with Jesus. Let's have a word of prayer. Lord, for those who are under the sound of my voice, right now, touch them. Move on their life. Let them know that you are still the author and the finisher of our faith. Strengthen them on every leaning side. Give them a reassurance that if God be for me, who can be against me? We trust you today. We have faith in you today. We believe God. Amen. Listen, the information is before you. You can make a decision. Jesus, do so today. Do so now while you still have time. There's an old song said he's an on-time God. And I want to tell you, yes, yes he is. Listen, on this first Sunday as we gather, as we take time, I want you to prepare. Scripture says as often as you do it in remembrance of me. We want to prepare to go to the Lord's table. To have communion, to break bread together. Though we are physically apart, we can be spiritually connected. If you would, prepare yourself to break bread and drink of the cup. It's a time of renewal. Let's have prayer. Lord, we prepare now to go to your table to break bread and drink of the cup in remembrance of you. Reminded of how you suffered, bled, died on Calvary so all of us would have a right to the tree of life. And then early on Sunday morning, you got up with all power, resurrection power, getting up power in your hands. Because you got up, we can get up from every knockdown, every fall, every disappointment. Thank you for a privilege, an opportunity to break bread and drink of the cup. Scripture declares, as often as you do it in remembrance of me. Amen. Let's prepare to break bread and break bread together. Scripture says, Jesus took the bread, blessed it, and broke it, and said, take ye eat. This is my body. Let us break bread. Amen. God bless you. In like manner, he took the cup and said, this is my blood of the New Testament shed for many for the remission of sins. Let us drink of the cup together. Thank you for being a part of the service. Thank you for tuning in. Our prayer continually is that you keep the faith. Trust in the Lord. It makes all the difference in the world. God bless you until we meet again. Be blessed.
say blessed, say blessed.